So kind of tricks of the trade. This is very important, keywords, because if I'm going out, let's say I have a job opening, and I'm going to go out and source, and that means I'm going to go out and find you. You're not applying for my job. Your resume is just out there on Career Builder, Monster, wherever it might be. I might type in, let me use a different one. Let's use HR. Clerk. Recruiting. Any kind of keywords that will pop up, it's going to pull from your resume. So if you're only putting the description of what you did, filing, anything like that, not additional, I'm not going to pull your resume. So I might not even see it. As you said, why is anybody calling? It could be because your keywords are not able to pull off any kind of database. So that's something we really need to look at. Relevant words are critical to pulling. Example, Career Builder, Monster, internal databases. If you apply at Tyson, Walmart, JB Hunt, they have an internal database that they can source and search your resume even if you haven't applied for a specific position, but it ties back to keywords. And a keyword is anything in your resume, it will pull automatically that you've used. So if I'm using a programmer, I'm going to type in maybe a certain language. You could include job titles, locations, computer languages, certifications, and companies. So for job titles, you can go to different company job sites and they have all these very savvy titles. You can, I don't want to say you can change your title, but you can make your title where it's more relevant. So if I'm a, I don't know, let's say in our group we have recruiting coordinators. A lot of companies might put HR clerk or recruiting clerk or recruiting assistant. You might change it, it's still recruiting, and add coordinator. Anything like that that will change your title and your search words a little, but not change the title where I call your boss or your former employer or reference and they're like, that's not what she did. So you can kind of become a little creative, wouldn't you say, Caroline? Because your titles are so, they sound very good.
Product manager, brand manager, marketing manager are all, they're all basically interchangeable depending on the company you work for.
Yes.
So yeah, I mean, if you want to add those keywords, if that's the position that you're looking for.
And it's kind of the industry standard, if that's what's known in the industry. If it's not, it probably wouldn't help you very much. Action verbs and phrases, sell your duties, responsibilities, and transferable skills. Not just, I did this, I promoted, I collaborated, I maintained, anything like that. Use those words that show that you've taken a little bit more time and it wasn't just I showed up at work, but you put I brought cocktail drinks to the table. I mean, kind of think of the way you're writing it. Simple, short words. Keep sentences under 20 words. You don't even have to put periods at the end of them. You can, again, be consistent. A lot of times when you look at a resume, it's not a full sentence. It's more of a, did this, responsible for this. Voice and tense should remain consistent. So this is one thing, I'll read a resume and it's a past job, it's written in present form. And then I go to the current job and it's written in future. So just kind of look at how you're writing it. You don't want to change it too much. If it's a previous job, I usually say use past form, maintained. In the current job, I might put maintain. Just make sure it's consistent. And then the length. One page for every 10 years of relevant experience. So to your question, you have 11 years. So you're right there. Most of it probably wouldn't be relevant to what you're looking for. So we want to get it down to that one page. Any questions? Okay, this is an example of what external skills and experiences are you bringing to the company. Here's the things you want to highlight. You know, your language skills, leadership responsibilities, contract negotiations, profit and loss. If you've had any experience with budgets, technical expertise, this is what you want to include somewhere in your resume. Computer training. That's very important because I'm surprised by how many people do not use simple, like Excel. If you don't know Excel, that's fine, but I'm surprised a lot of people don't and they list it, and then in the interview it comes out that, yeah, I took class one time. And don't list anything that you really do not know. You can bring that up in the interview. Yes, I used an Excel class. I haven't used it in 2 years, but I know I'll be able to do it because I've done this, this, and that.
Would you put that on the actual resume or on the cover letter?
Excel, you would put that under computer skills.
You would make a section that says...
So yes, so if you have like computer skills, especially if you're looking for ways to stretch it out, computer skills, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, especially if you're going to be using PowerPoint. So I would use the job description of what computer skills they require. Make sure it's on your resume. And do not be alarmed, because if you haven't used Outlook, that's very easy. We can teach that. Do not worry about those. A lot of people worry about putting every little skill they've had. Do not worry about the little ones. I'd say Excel and PowerPoint are probably the ones that I get questioned the most on, hey, do they have this, do they not? Cover letter. Cover letter is important. I'll be honest with you. If you apply for a job with me, I will look at your cover letter. Most likely the hiring manager will not see it at all. People spend more time on their cover letter than they do their resume. I would not spend as much time. I would include, as you said, hey, I was off for 2 years doing this, because I will make sure I relay that to the hiring manager. Hey, I know you had some questions. I looked at their cover letter. They did explain it. But I know, I mean, my husband worries about his cover letter more than his resume. People, I know, talk cover letter, cover letter. Do not feel pressured to write one. It's not always required. If it is, it will be noted. But it is a great way to highlight transferable skills and anything else that maybe you want to address on gaps. It can yield an interview, yes and no. I let my team read this, and they were like, you put a cover letter? Why are you talking about it? We don't even look at them. There are companies that do require them. You'll see it, especially in the newspaper. It backs your cover letter and resume. You need to include it if it's asked for. Again, employer and position specific. Change the name, change the title, change the date. Look at all that stuff. And that's one thing, read the requirements. If it says go to apply here, go there. Don't just hit the button to submit, because a lot of times, I've seen in the paper specifically, do not apply here, go to this, go to that. So make sure you are reading the ways to submit it. I'll go over this briefly. It's brief. It's never more than 3 to 4 short paragraphs, and it could be 2 to 3 sentences per paragraph. General interest in your skill set. It can help get your resume noticed. So it can help if it's explaining some type of gap of employment or a transferable skill. Introduction, so make sure you have the right person. If you don't, you can put dear HR representative. There's nothing wrong with that. If you somehow find out who the recruiter is, who the hiring manager is, you can gear it specifically to them. Qualifications, education. Don't spend so much time on this unless it's not on your resume or it's additional information. So don't just rewrite your resume in a form, a cover letter. Enthusiasm, and then a time frame or a timeline on when you'll follow up. You don't necessarily have to put that. There's nothing wrong with following up. If you know who the recruiter is, reaching out. I get calls all the time, hey, Kristen, do you have any idea of when you'll hear something or when I should know something? I'll honestly say sometimes I don't. I meet with the hiring manager next week. If they're not in a hurry, it could be 2 to 3 months. The problem we run into is if we tell you that and you call every day. And I have people, and I know they're eager, and people will tell you, call, show your eagerness. There's a way to call, hey, Kristen, I'm going to follow up with you in 2 weeks. Great. I know you're going to call back in 2 weeks. There's nothing wrong with that. But if they tell you, we're not going to know anything for a month, and you call every day.
You become a pain.
Yeah, your eagerness becomes a little bit more. There's nothing wrong with it. You should show, but just don't continue to call when you do have a time frame or agree. Hey, can I call back in a week? You think you'll know anything? There's nothing wrong with it.